which moment and when they see us brought me to tears. I'm gonna talk about it. Welcome to the top 10 most impactful moments from Ava DuVernay's Netflix miniseries, When They See Us. And these are 10 moments that just really hit me, really impacted me, either made me really think introspectively about my own life or introspectively, or maybe these are moments that provided so much social commentary on the criminal justice system, on racism. They're just 10 moments that I think really defied When They See Us for me. And everyone would absolutely have their own favorite moments, so let me know yours. If you want to know my full thoughts on the review, you can check out the video here or wherever. Well, let's get started with this list at number 10. At number 10 is Life After Lockup. In these moments, we find four of our Central Park Five, how their life is doing after being incarcerated for 10 to 14 years. They find it hard to really adjust to life, like their family and society has left them behind. Raymond Jr. comes back to a home where his father has married a new woman and they don't get along together, and just the way she treats him is, he just doesn't fit anywhere. Both Raymond and Yusef is having really hard time finding jobs, and that's because when you've been incarcerated for so long, when you're a felon, you do not have the opportunity to really better your life. I think this clearly represents the notion of what a prison's supposed to do. Like, it's supposed to rehabilitate you. It's supposed to send you back into society as a better person, ready to make better decisions. But what the criminal system tends to do is just punish you, and punishes you throughout your whole entire life to where you can't really make amends for what you did, and you can't make a positive impact on society. Number 9, When They See Us, and also just the fear mongering. There's a very specific scene where Linda Farstein is talking to the police about how these boys are monsters, and they went from person to person attacking people, and how they then raped her. Like, she is just gathering up all this fear. I mean, fear is very powerful. It can get people to act irrational, and you can use it to manipulate people, and that's what she's doing here. And also, the media is guilty of this. There was a journalist just trying to write out his entry into the newspaper, and it just completely villainizes these boys without really being unbiased in it. So you sort of start conditioning people to where when they see a young black man, they don't see, you know, a young black boy. They see monsters, they see animals, they see unruly people. Number 8, Yusef's mother stops the interview. This moment is so powerful. It just completely epitomizes the strength and the power of a mother's love. You know, when she goes in, she stops that interview. She stands up to Linda Farstein. And when she walks to the interrogation room and Yusef sees her face, he just crumbles. He just crumbles into her bosom. Like, that is her baby. Like, she is going to protect him. And it's an interesting dichotomy here, because he is fairly tall, much taller than her, but he just shrinks inside of her. Like, that is how powerful a mother's love can be. In her confrontation with Linda, saying, "How dare you do this? You grab this boy and you question him, a minor, in front of these men for hours without a guardian present," and how she should be ashamed of it. Very powerful moment. Number 7, the verdict. We go through the court proceedings and the hearing and hear all the testimony. And I didn't know all the nuances and the details of the trial, and so I really didn't know how it ended. I had an idea, but I didn't really know. You hear police and how they contradict each other. You hear about the sock and how the semen evidence doesn't match any of the boys. And you start building up a little optimism. Like, Ava DuVernay directed this in a sense where you started feeling very hopeful. Like, it seemed like the tide was in their favor. And then the verdict comes in, and the boys are found guilty. And all the parents' reactions are just heartbreaking. And some of the boys, they all react to it so differently. Some of them are somewhat crying uncontrollably, some of them just a tear, some of them are in shock. Then the episode begins to end, and it juxtaposes them and their trial being found guilty with them and their normal lives, living with their family and their friends. Like, that's who they really are. They're not this guilty party who raped and beat this young woman. Number 5, Kevin playing the trumpet. One of the moments after the guilty verdict just shows an image of Kevin holding a trumpet, and he's handcuffed though. It is a very small moment, but I think it speaks volumes. I think it fully epitomizes that young Black men have aspirations, they have dreams, but often those dreams are cut short by racism and by cops, and we've seen that. Number six, When We See Us. This is a combination of a lot of moments. I mentioned before, when they give him that guilty verdict, I mean, it shows all these quick images of them and their family. Like, these are what these boys are. They're brothers, they're sons, they're friends. They're not monsters. And so to their family and friends, when they see them, you know, they're not monsters, they're not that way. But unfortunately to other people, they don't see it that way. And I think that's at the root of a lot of racism, is that, you know, all of us, every single one of us have racism built into us. If you say you've never been racist or you're colorblind, you are lying. You need to look within yourself and reevaluate some things, because we all have that, because that's the way our brain works. When we see something, we associate things we've seen in the past to it. So if the news has just hammered you in with young Black men are criminals, when you see young Black men, you're gonna think he's a criminal. But it's important to stop yourself and think, no, that is just a human being. That is just a son. That's possibly just someone's brother. That is just someone who can have a bright future. I think it's a great moment with a white corrections officer here. He's a prison guard who has been really nice to Corey, relatively speaking. And, you know, he talks to Corey like a real human being. He looks out for him. He buys him a cheetah pet. As Corey kind of is having a really hard time in prison, eventually Corey asks him, like, why are you helping me? Why do you look out for me? What do you get out of this? And he responds with, like, I have a son, and I would want someone to treat him well if he was in the same situation. So that means when he sees Corey, he doesn't see a monster. He doesn't see a criminal. He sees his son. If everyone did that, if everyone saw other people as human beings in their own lives, they would have so much more kind to them. Because then you start empathizing with people. You start understanding them even more. Number four, Kevin's sister defends him. In this moment, after Kevin has been interviewed and questioned, and the cops have finally coerced him into giving a false statement, his sister comes in and he sees her, and he's really elated to see her. And she reads the statements and everything, and then he says, I didn't do it. And she's like, he says he didn't do it. He didn't do it. Why are you guys making him sign this? I will admit, personally, this moment really hit me really hard. There was one time in my life where me and my friends, we go to the park, and we're all young and Black. We're probably like 13 to 14. Come back from the park. This guy comes up to us and like, hey, you motherfuckers stole my lawnmower. We're like, we didn't steal your lawnmower. He's like, no, these people over here say, it was an old white couple, say that you three stole my lawnmower. You guys better get my lawnmower back here. In the next 30 minutes, I'm calling the cops. And we keep telling like, you can go ask people at the park. We can call the cops. They're like, will you go get your parents and stuff? My friend's parents weren't home. My dad wasn't home. I go and I check, but my sister's there. So my sister comes down. You know, I have like four older sisters, very similar to Kevin in real life. My sister comes out to him. She's like, says something very similar to Kevin's sister. She says, if he says he didn't do it, then he didn't do it. Like, that is the love of, you know, a family. Like, they always got your back. So shout out to Whitney. If she's watching this, she's probably gonna make me call her and tell her I love her and stuff like that, but whatever. Actually, it turns out this white boy actually stole the lawnmower. Like, these other people came by, was like, no, they didn't do it. We saw him do it, and he hid it over here. And of course, that dude didn't curse at him at all. So, you know, that dude was real racist. But then finishing up Kevin's moment, after his sister's there, he's begging her to just sign the papers. Like, and this acting is done so tremendously well. I think his name is Ashanti Black. He looks so desperate. He just wants to be out of there. That's how desperate these kids were. I definitely cried in this moment because I just connected with this moment so much. Number three, Corey's vision. Corey had what seems like the worst time in prison out of all the kids. He served a longer sentence and he was in a much rougher prison. In his time in prison, he finds out that his sister died. He gets attacked multiple times, almost to the point of dying. It was actually a miracle that he survived. And it gets to a certain point where he just kind of starts to lose sense of reality. Also, he does this thing that we all do when something terrible happens to us or we do something terrible. We start doing this mental time travel or just this, well, something so minor change. What if he actually stayed with his girlfriend at the restaurant and didn't go to the park? He starts imagining these things and talking to himself out loud. It's such a powerful, hopeful moment. You know, he starts imagining this world where they go to Coney Island and everything is just bright. In a way, I think this is what he sort of had to do, sort of what a mind trick on you to keep you hopeful. It kept him from just succumbing to that anger and that aggression, that one hope that things can be better. I was very emotional in this moment. I definitely cried in this moment. Number two, Antron's father tells him to lie. This moment, I think, carries so much weight. Antron's father clearly has somewhat of a shady background. Maybe he didn't have a good relationship with the law before this. You know, he's trying to be better. He's trying not to be in trouble. And he finds Antron in a terrible situation. So just to get him out of it, he tells him to lie. But Antron wants to hold on to the truth. But he like forces him, like, listen to me, I'm your father. These people will kill you. They will take away your rights. They don't care. And then goes like, but you don't know about that yet. This moment epitomizes how Black parents seem to be far more aware of racism than their kids are. I mean, and that's the way it is. Like, they grew up in a much different time. Like, one time I told my mom that I saw this white girl who I knew in a class in college. She was walking and she was going to work. So I gave her a ride to work. I picked her up, gave her a ride to work. Told my mom, thinking like, oh, I was being a good Samaritan. And she was like, dead serious. She's like, boy, don't you do that again. Because our parents have lived through some racist stuff. Also, I think this moment really mirrors Black fathers during slavery and how they were so powerless to protect and provide for their family, how they were just at the mercy of the masters and they had to do and say whatever they wanted them to do or say. And this moment is really harsh because reading the interviews, he says that he's never forgiven his father for this. Like, even to this day after his father's passed away, in a recent interview, he called his father a coward and how he made him lie. That is just so, so heartbreaking. And the number one moment is simply just freedom. After all these years, after they have held on to their truth, the truth finally comes out for everybody to see. And one by one, Ava DuVernay shows how they react to the truth, shows where they are at, shows just how it impacted them. In that triumphant moment that they all come together and raise hands and freedom, shackled no more, is just a powerful moment. All right, so there's my list of the top 10 most impactful moments of When They See Us. That is clearly my opinion. I would love to know yours. Please comment below. You can watch more of my videos here. Please like, comment, and consider subscribing. And sincerely, thank you for watching. I'm out.